babies. So cute, cuddly, observant, bright-eyed and full of wonder, little miracles. And all of them have a beginning that usually starts back much further than 9 months. It may have been 5 years before when their parents met one time at a local beach, or 7 years back when the parents met in the Stop and Shop parking lot. But during the season of Advent, we celebrate the birth of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who came to us in the form of a baby. And were circumstances a wee bit different while leading up to the child's birth, I think we can all agree that this world would be a very different place in which to live. Let me introduce you to one of the least mentioned, but the most influential character of the Christmas story, Joseph. Please say hello to the congregation, Joseph. Joseph was a simple man, but his dilemma was not. He was about to marry the beautiful Mary, but before they were to marry, it was made known that Mary was with child, and it was not Joseph's. In today's society, that was definitely not dinner talk. Imagine what it would be like in Joseph's time. There would probably be deadly consequences involved, but they didn't. End of story. But I don't want to end the story here. I want you all to think, what if? What if Joseph did not accept Mary as his wife? That nearly happened. I'm going to show you a few scenarios involving Joseph and the angel sent from God telling Joseph of the importance of Jesus' birth and all that goes with it. Observe.
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife.
What? What? What?
No, no. That's not how it happened. Joseph was a strong young man, looking forward to a future with a new wife. No, let's try this again.
Joseph, son of God, please do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
Just a moment, please. I have already decided to divorce her quietly, so no one will get hurt. Please, don't try to make me feel guilty for doing this. Now I need some sleep. Sorry.
Joseph was a very conscientious carpenter and hard worker, but this did not come before his love for God. But what if the scenario was this one?
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son.
Stop right there. I have no intention of marrying this woman. How can I trust her? She betrayed me and my family. She has humiliated me. What if the whole village knew of this story? I have a good mind to tell them, but they will think I am a fool for believing this story. Just leave me be. Go!
Ooh. What if that were the story? Did you ever think of what this world would have been like without our Savior? What would our existence consist of? Would we even exist? But Jesus entered the world as our Lord and Savior, thanks in part to Joseph. Observe.
Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins.
Yes, the Son of God, and I will call him Jesus.
Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us in that tiny baby. Joseph did exactly what the angel requested of him. Was he afraid of that angel? Who wouldn't be? But Joseph's faith and trust were greater than his fears. He was a man of God and a man of great love and grace, for he welcomed the Lord to use him as a vessel in order to introduce Jesus to mankind and to this world. Amen.
Please join me in our prayer of invocation that is found in your bulletin. Gentle One,
in this time of preparation and planning,
help us to have patience,
to make time for loved ones,
and to discover abundant compassion.
Bring us the peace we long to have,
and that you unfailingly offer us.
Teach us the peace that comes from justice.
Prepare our hearts to be transformed by you,
that we may walk in the light of Christ.
Amen. Our first reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 2, verse 1 through 5, and can be found on page 587 in your pew Bible if you'd like to follow along. The word which Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem: it shall come to pass in the later days that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains, and shall be raised above the hills, and all nations shall flow to it. And many peoples shall come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us his ways, and that we may walk in his paths." For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He shall judge between the nations and shall decide for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. O house of Jacob, come let us walk in the light of the Lord. Our second reading comes from Matthew chapter 1, verse 18 to 25. It can be found on page 835 in your pew Bible. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child of the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being just a man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, "Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary your wife, for that which is conceived in her is the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet: "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had borne a son, and he called his name Jesus. May the word bless the reading and the hearing of the word. Amen.
After the service was over, the congregation filed out and were shaking the hands of the pastor, and no one said anything much about the sermon. But towards the end of the line was a man who liked to keep the peace, and he always liked to make everybody happy. And so he said to him as he shook his hand, your sermon was like the peace and love of God. And the guy was thrilled. And he's like, wow, thank you so much. No one said that about my sermon before. What was it about the sermon? And the man was like, oh, rats, because he also was committed to telling the truth. And he said, well, it was like the peace of God because it passed all understanding. And it was like the love of God because it endured forever. So here comes a sermon like the peace and love of God. Just get ready right now. But peace is something that we all long for, isn't it? I mean, we all do. We long for peace, whether it's in our own hearts and to have a sense of peace, or in our families, you know, to figure out how to get along, and even more, you know, how to feel that swell of love when we're together. In our communities, in our world, we yearn for it. But today, it seems like peace gets farther and farther away. It seems like a pipe dream. It doesn't seem realistic to yearn for peace. There have been different times in our history when that sense, that hope of knowing that peace is going to come, and maybe it's going to come sometime soon, was part of the sense of the nation or even of the world. There was a feeling that maybe what we were doing was cultivating the seeds of peace that would spread to the world, and eventually the whole world was going to live in peace. I've read about World War I, you know, and it was considered the war to end all wars. There was this feeling that if it went well, that there never would be war again. And you may remember hearing the story, which is a true story, about the troops on the front line on Christmas Eve singing Silent Night to each other over the no man's land and greeting each other with Merry Christmas. And all along the front in World War I, peace kept breaking out in the midst of the war. But we know that World War II came so quickly on the heels of the war to end all wars. And we have so many since then, so many engagements that most of us can't even list them all. I was talking to some of our 20 and 30-year-olds in the household over Thanksgiving, and I was just talking about how, you know, someday maybe we're going to have peace, and they didn't believe it would ever come. And I tried to understand a little bit further and realized, you know, for their generation, for their whole generation, the cloud of 9/11, the shadow of 9/11 is cast. And that sense that, you know, we're somehow powerless to bring peace in our world is maybe something that's felt by a generation. And now I can see why they feel hopeless, because in our country we're more polarized than ever. We can't even seem to find ways to talk to each other, and we're in the same country. We have, you know, basically the same hopes and dreams. But the basic teaching of the Bible is about peace. There's so many parts of the Bible that encourage us to it and give us a vision of it. And so we need to be about it. We know that we do. And I think there are two different basic ways that the Bible talks about peace. The scripture from Isaiah that Jason read, the lectionary for today, talks about this beautiful vision when all the nations of the world come to the mountain of the Lord, and God is the one that's going to arbitrate the differences between us. So we know it's going to be fair, we know it's going to be just, and we don't have to disagree with God about it, because we know, you know, that before the Lord, that we're going to get what we deserve, for better or for worse. And at that point, we can beat our swords into plowshares and our spears into pruning hooks, like all the machinery of war becomes the tools to feed the world. And it says, nation shall not war against any other nation. Nation shall not lift up sword against any nation. Neither shall there be war anymore. That was a vision in Isaiah 2,000 years before Christ, maybe almost 4,000 years ago. The vision of peace that permeates the Bible is described in other scripture passages too, and it's expanded. Like in Ezekiel, it talks about even the weather, you know, is going to live in peace with us. Like there's going to be rain at the right time, and we aren't going to have these storms that disrupt our lives, and there's going to be enough food because the rain and the soil is going to be peaceful because it's going to be able to grow things, and the wild animals aren't going to fight with each other, and we don't need to be afraid of them anymore. There's this description of the incredible harmony of what peace means, that peace is about having truth and true justice and mercy and love. This description of the many facets of peace. And one of the things that it says, too, is that God's going to bring that peace. That this is what God is going to do. That God gives us this vision and God's going to realize the vision. But then there's these other scriptures in the Bible, and it's about what we're supposed to do. It's about our action. And that in almost all of Paul's letters, we are told that we're supposed to respect each other's differences and we're supposed to speak the truth in love with and for each other, and we're supposed to find a way to be one community because we need each other so much. I mean, that's the whole point of some of those letters in Corinthians and Colossians and Ephesians. We need each other so much, we got to figure out how to do it together. In Thessalonians, it talks about not seeking revenge, but doing good to the other. If your enemy is hungry, feed your enemy. If your enemy is thirsty, find drink for your enemy. Mercy, mercy, compassion, forgiveness, it's part of peace. But I'll tell you what, if you're really, truly working for peace, it can be one of the most unpeaceful experiences that you can have, because really trying to listen to someone that you vehemently disagree with, or that irritating relative that you just want to walk out the door and say, I don't have to deal with you anymore, you know, it's hard. And the choices and judgments that we have to make in this complex journey of finding ways to live in harmony or live in peace, you know, it's incredibly difficult because, as I said, peace has a lot of components to it. So peace is trying to figure out, as it says in Psalm 85, it's truth, you know? Like, what is actually the truth? I mean, not the fake news that has become so much a part of our culture, but what is really true? And maybe sometimes what truth is depends on the lens that you use to look at it. And so there are different facets of truth. Peace means discovering what justice is, and it means listening to all the voices and the ones that are powerless, you know, finding ways to lift them up so they have a way to speak and to be included. And it means justice, you know, trying to make it right. That's part of peace. And mercy, too. Because, you know what, you can't fix everything you did wrong in the past. No one can. And so trying to figure out what you're going to be able to forgive. You know, what kinds of things you're just going to have to let go of to live into a future. And most of all, peace includes love. And it means seeing the humanity of each one. Like, we are all human beings together. And we need to find ways to acknowledge that and to see the eye of Christ in each one. There's some good news coming up real soon, because if you think back over the history of 300 years in North America, ever since the Revolutionary War in 1776, there's been a war somewhere in the Americas. continuously there's been some warfare going on in some place in North, Central, or South America. Sometimes the wars were international, sometimes they were civil wars, sometimes it was indigenous people against the foreign forces, war after war, overlapping in time. You know what? Very soon, we're about to come to the end of the era of war in North, Central, and South America. Did you know that? There's been a war going on for a little over 50 years in Colombia. In 1966, the FARC rebels, F-A-R-Q, decided to make war against the government because they felt like it was oppressive. And that war has been going on since then, costing millions of dollars and many, many lives. And the FARC rebels turned to guerrilla warfare and extortion and kidnappings and executions. And they started trying to find the journey towards peace in 1984. They had a peace process, a ceasefire that had been worked out all the way back in 1984. But it didn't last very long because a paramilitary group killed 3,000 people that was part of the new political party that had been formed. You know, it was a peace that didn't have any mercy in it, because they felt like, you know, for what they've done, they should die. And then later on, there was a government that they decided they were going to try to wipe out all the rebels. And the government started increasing the military and trying to wipe out all the rebels in the country so that there would be peace. That was a peace without any justice, and the country became even more violent. And then they started a process where they tried to look at truth and justice and mercy and love. They started a process where they started to listen to the stories and listening to the women and children in this peace process. And when they listened to the whole stories of women and children, they were able to identify more clearly what is it that we need to change in order to have peace. They listened to all the voices of all the parties, and they constructed this agreement in August. You might remember, it was in the news all over the place. They constructed this agreement, and it was signed by all the parties, and it went to a referendum to the public. It was voted down because I think people felt there wasn't enough justice, that there needed to be more justice in this vision of peace. So just this past week, they signed an agreement, agreed to by both sides. It has 6 points, and I'm not going to go into the details. You can look it up in the paper. But it was hard work of uncovering the truth and finding ways to have justice and incorporating mercy, and in the end, finding ways to love each other and listen to each other and be together as one country. And you know what? It might just happen. It might just happen very soon, something that we may not have ever thought was possible. If you remember back for decades, there were wars and rumors of wars all over North and Central and South America, and we might have a time of peace. A time of peace. One woman who is talking about it says, "We only ultimately got to it because we're able to recognize everyone on all sides of the conflict as human beings. To make progress, the wounds of mistrust and fear and resentment and hatred that have been festering for so many years have got to be healed." Wow. Just feel the miracle of that peace. And I want to invite you to think about your own families, too, because sometimes coming to peace in our relationships with our family members includes figuring out the truth and the justice and the mercy and the love of it. I was talking to a friend a couple of weeks ago, and he gave me permission to tell you about this. I'm just going to call him Randy. And he said that his dad was one who was an autocrat, always had so many rules about everything. And any time when he was growing up, if he broke one of those rules, he was not only punished, but he was shamed and humiliated for breaking one of those rules. And even as he got to be adult, you know, his dad just looked at everything in one way, and there was no room for his opinion. And he was actually afraid to tell his dad what he thought. And so they were talking on the phone one time, and it was something minor. He didn't even tell me what it was because it was so minor. And he disagreed with his dad. And for the first time, instead of just falling in line like he'd always done, he said, "You know, I don't agree with you." And they got into a kind of a little argument that escalated, and he found himself yelling at his dad and telling him all the things he thought he'd done wrong as a father, and his dad hung up the phone. And guess what? They stopped talking to each other. It was like such a little thing. And eventually, they'd go to the family gatherings. He still went to the family gatherings, but he and his dad wouldn't even say hello to each other. They'd just be in the same room year after year, you know? And the longer it went, the worse it got. And then one year, just before he was supposed to get together with his family, he had a dream. He had a dream that his father died, and the only way he knew about it was that he read the obituary in the paper. And it like shook him. And all of a sudden he realized, oh, this has got to stop. So when they gathered together, he went in and he sat down with his dad, who was watching television, and just sat and watched the game with him. And he wasn't much of a football fan, so he had to read about the game ahead of time so he could intelligently talk about the game. But hey, you know, they talked about the game together. And then the next time they got together, he asked his dad, you know, like about work, some of the things he was doing. And the next time he got together, his dad asked him a few things about how it was going. And they ended up having the longest conversation that they had had in a decade, that third time they got together. And he went home, and he suddenly realized, you know, that originally his plan had been he would try to get closer to his dad enough so he could tell his dad what he was had really done wrong and try to get him to admit he was wrong and try to make it right like that. But in that moment, he realized, you know what? He didn't care if he was right or wrong. He just wanted to figure out how to have a relationship with his dad. And they were able to. They were able to for a number of years before his dad passed away. And gradually he realized it wasn't just that he was trying to be different in his relationship with his father, but he realized his father was reaching back, you know, to try to understand him more and understand how he was different and understand how it might have been hard growing up. Christ calls us to be peacemakers. And it is hard, hard work. It requires us to be honest with ourselves and to be able to see places we might be wrong. It requires us to extend ourselves in times that we don't really want to have anything to do with the other one. It requires us to pray, to pray, to pray, to have patience, to be willing to forgive, and most of all, it requires us to find ways to look into the eyes of every single one and to see the eyes of Christ looking back at us. Amen. Let us join together in the hymn.
You know what?
technical challenge. It's going to be fixed in...
Pray for peace. Thank you.